Izraelska rediteljka Ada Ušpic 4 godine radila je dokumentarni film o Hani Arendt, filozofkinji jevrijskog porekla, čija su razmišljanja o holokaustu izazvala snažna oprečna osjećanja u Americi i u jevrijskoj zajednici širom sveta. Hana Arendt objavila je svoju knjigu Eichmann u Jerusalimu nakon praćenja suđenja ovom visoko pozicioniranom nacističkom funkcioneru 1961. godine. U ovoj emisiji Ada Ušpic, rediteljka filma Duh Hane Arendt, govori o tome zašto je ova filozofkinja bila napadana, zašto su je preživjeli holokausta optuživali za izdaju, u kakvoj su vezi, prema mišljenju Hane Arendt, odsustvo mišljenja i zločin, zašto je danas mladima lakše da shvate Haninu tezu o banalnosti zla i da li imamo pravo da promišljamo zlo ako nismo bili direktne žrtve zločina.
Yeah, she came to Israel in 1961 and she covered the trial of Eichmann, Adolf Eichmann, the Nazi, known, very well known Nazi criminal. And then she wrote a book that the title of it was Eichmann in Jerusalem, a report of the banality of evil. Now, she used this phrase, banality of evil, only twice in this book. It was in the title and in the end when she says that even in front of death, whatever he was capable of is to cite that Nazi cliché. He just was incapable of thinking of anything else, and he was incapable of thinking at all. And this is a lesson, this is the last lesson he gave us of the banality of evil. This is how she used it. But it's true that the whole the book is really a kind of analyzing his way of thinking. Through the evidence of the interrogation, of his interrogation by defense and by the prosecution. And this way of thinking is really give you a kind of understanding of the world of evildoer in our society, in this kind of society, the Nazi society. So it was accepted very, it was the 60s in Israel. Israel in the 60s is a very young country. And this country is trying to build its ethos and its national ethos. And everything was built at this time on Holocaust in many respects. Holocaust was a very important issue in our self-identification because it was also a very great trauma of these people, for sure. I mean, she didn't realize that she is creating a problem for these people because it was a need to believe, a very strong need to believe, straight after the world, in Germany, in America, and in Israel, that we are dealing with monsters here. And that and Eichmann and the Nazi criminals are monsters, are demons, and this is the way we can distance ourselves from them and just, you know, victimize ourselves in a better way. And it was not only in Israel, it was in America, it was in Germany itself, when they tried to distance themselves from the relatives that were involved directly in this terrible crime. And Arendt came with such with such a different outlook, and she in so many ways was ahead of her time.
He was certainly an idealist. An idealist, according to Eichmann, isn't only someone who believes in his idea, but he also lives for this idea. And he is ready to sacrifice everything for it, and especially everyone. The longer one listened to him, the more obvious it became that his inability to speak was closely connected with an inability to think, namely to think from the standpoint of somebody else. And the German society of 80 million people had been shielded against reality and factuality by exactly the same means. The same self-deception, lies, and dumbness that had now become ingrained in Eichmann's mentality.
I mean, she really understood that we are not, this is not an other planet. It's happened in this planet, in this world. And really, the idea of banality of evil, even if she doesn't use this phrase so often, it's intertwined in all her thinking, and you can find it everywhere because it's really the way evil is, as she said in one place, penetrate into the senses of reality. I mean, it's just penetrating into our everyday life in a way that we almost, and I say this is my take on it, we almost create an alternative world where everything looks normal, completely normal, and we have the same pattern of behavior, and we have even the same kind of alternative feelings. We can create alternative moral. We can feel ourselves very moral, doing the most terrible things and still feel ourselves very moral. So all these kind of strategies of evil to penetrate into the world was, and to see the evil, the Nazi evil in this light was very annoying for many people in Israel and in America. And that's what, and in Israel there was also, she was Jewish and she was considered one of us, and all of a sudden she doesn't really demonstrate a special love for these people on expense of other people, which is, this is the basic of any national thinking and national sentiments. So yeah, she got excommunicated almost, and she was very, very persecuted, even, you know, spiritually, not real persecution, but spiritual. She was persecuted, she felt persecuted. She felt like people made a character murder to her. And they were all her friends, all belonged to her generation, in Israel I speak. So it was a very painful thing for her.
I would find myself, as late as 10 years ago, I'd give a lecture on, I'd been in Jerusalem, and somebody in the audience would get up and start screaming at me. How could I defend this vicious anti-Semite?
And this going on today too, because wherever you come to, wherever you tackle a conservative way of thinking, when she comes with the idea, and never mind that people can say that she was conservative also in some, to some point, but whenever you come to the idea that she actually underlined our sense of being decent citizens because we are comply with our ethoses and with our norms, with our conventions, and she tells you actually, beware, all this, all the accepted world is imbued with evil. And there are like automatic process of evil that imbued in this, world of norms, of conventions, of national ethoses, of, you know, stereotypes, cliché. We have to start thinking. We cannot afford ourselves to be swept away by this. And you may be a very decent citizen, but you are an evil person. Beware, and this is really annoying. People feel sometimes, especially when you are very conservative and you want to go along with whatever is around you and whatever is accepted and whatever is considered by majority to be the good and the decent. So that's why she even today, many times create kind of antagonism to her thinking.
Oh, no, I'm sure he was anti-Semitic, and I'm sure that he loved his Führer and that he swore allegiance to the Nazi ideology. I mean, there's no question about that. So it is this non-thinking adoption of fascist, racist ideologies, which she is saying belongs to a kind of new way of life, a new modality. It has become, under those conditions, it became normal. It is hideous that it's normal. It's hideous that it is banal. Right, if we say that this evil became banal, ordinary, taken for granted, normal, we are describing a very hideous reality. So she is not saying it is banal. She's saying it's a new form of hideousness that is able to pass itself off as the normal, which is why we have to be all the more alert.
There is in the book also, she relates to the problem of the Judenrat, the Jewish leaders in the ghettos. And she blamed them to cooperate with the Nazi regime, in the way that they helped to make order in the ghettos, and by making order, they facilitate the atrocities, because they helped them to keep like industrial quietness, you know. And yeah, she wrote what she wrote, and I think also that she wasn't very delicate and very, very subtle in her analysis here. But she wrote what she wrote, first of all, from the evidence of the trial, and the 60s were a time when everybody, the survivors of the Holocaust, thought the same. I mean, I'm a second generation of Holocaust, and I remember my mother, she hated everything that was concerned to the Judenrat.
The well-known fact that the actual work of killing in the extermination centers and keeping order in the ghettos was usually in the hands of Jewish commandos had been fairly established by the prosecution. But this was only horrible. It was not a moral problem. It was true that the Jewish people had not been organized, that they had possessed no land, had no government, and no army, no youth with military training. But the whole truth was that the Jewish leadership cooperated in one way or another with the Nazis. The whole truth was that if the Jewish people had really been unorganized and leaderless, there would have been chaos and plenty of misery, but the total number of victims would hardly have been between 4.5 and 6 million people.
It very, very strong sentiments against the Judenrat in Israel among the survivors. So she wasn't so exceptional, and I don't know why people decided to criticize her so strongly. It's true, she's you know, you can expect from her more because she was a philosophical figure, and you expect from her more. But still, it was very conventional at this time to think this way. And the other thing that I want to say is that I think that maybe she didn't really talk in enough subtleties about the complex of the whole problem, but the research today and up today going too much to the extreme of the other side of the drive, like saying we cannot judge these people, and because we never was, you know, we never were in their place, and we cannot really put ourselves in their shoes, and we can never know what we will have been doing if we were in their place, which is true. No one of us knows, because it's a really impossible situation to be in the situation they were. But the importance of Hannah Arendt thinking is that you have to judge always, and you have to judge yourself. You take it into consideration, of course, but you cannot really renounce yourself from judging just because you are not you were not in this situation. The whole idea of thinking and of communication with other people and with ourselves is to imagine all the time what we would have done and what we should done in other situations that are alien to us. This is the kind of communication that we are striving at. And no one can be renounced for any judgment ever, because we always have to take into consideration all the point of view and everything, but we still need to judge ourselves and the world. So this direction of research that go to this other side of the drive, as I said, saying that we cannot judge, it's something also that I believe that it's now going back toward her way of thinking. And more research recently are dealing with individual cases and analyzing individual cases. And because there were people that under these circumstances really behaved incredibly brave and moral, in a moralistic, in a moral way, and other than the terrible things. So you know, you have really to see the whole picture. And a lot of this has to do with the personalities of the people.
Wir stellen uns doch unter einem Verbrecher jemanden vor mit verbrecherischen Motiven. Und wenn wir uns Eichmann begucken, dann hat verbrecherische Motive eigentlich überhaupt? Er wollte mitmachen. Er wollte wir sagen. Und dieses Mitmachen und dieses wir sagen wollen war ja ganz genug, um die allergrößten Verbrechen möglich zu machen. Es gab eine Alternative, hüben und drüben, und die hieß nicht mitmachen. Selber urteilen, bitteschön, das mache ich nicht mit. Ich setze nicht mein Leben ein, ich versuche zu entkommen. Ich versuche, wie ich um die andere Ecke komme, nicht wahr? Aber ich mache nicht mit. Und falls ich gezwungen sein sollte, mitzumachen, dann werde ich mir das Leben nehmen.
She actually meant that he wasn't a sadist and he wasn't insane and he wasn't demonic and he didn't, it wasn't that he decided to do evil for the sake of evil. And like Nietzsche and other philosophers, Hannah Arendt said, there is no evil for the sake of evil. Evil is the result of the outcome. There is all, she said, there is only egoistic evil. You know, it's always has, Nietzsche said it always had to do with survival. And Arendt said it has to do with withdrawing into yourself and being indifferent to the world. And don't look at reality even, don't tackle reality. In this sense, she said about Eichmann, he is a dump. It's not only that he was incapable to think from the point of view of the other, because he was dump. He just was indifferent to the world. He was indifferent to the other people. He was indifferent to the world. He was withdrawn into his world, which was the Nazi world. And he was incredible good Nazi idealist and Nazi citizen. And he was a great lover of the Führer, of the Nazi ideology. Of course, this was his world. This was the framework of his existence. And he exists in this framework of Nazi world thoughtlessness. He didn't need to think because everything was, was there for him. He just need to think about his career and about his life and about waking up in the morning and waking up in the morning and kissing his wife and kiss his children. And as one of the psychiatrists that checked him before the trial said, he has a very pleasant attitude with his family. Okay, so yeah, and he had. So this is, you can be a normal citizen, completely normal citizen in an evil world when you are comply and cooperate with this evil without thinking.
Eichmann war ganz intelligent, aber diese Dummheit hatte er. Das war die Dummheit, die so empörend war. Und das habe ich eigentlich gemeint mit der Banalität. Da ist keine Tiefe, das ist nicht dämonisch. Das ist einfach der Unwille, sich je vorzustellen, was eigentlich mit dem anderen ist. Nicht wahr? Ich habe keineswegs gemeint, der Eichmann sitzt in uns, jeder von uns hat den Eichmann und weiß der Deibel was. Nichts dergleichen.
People couldn't understand her humor. Even today, they don't understand her humor. When she said, of course he is anti-Semite. Yeah, she said it in such an ironically way. She never thought that he is not anti-Semite. She said, of course he is not anti-Semite. The sentence itself is much more complicated. I had to cut it I cut it a lot. You cannot really bring all her books in a movie. So it's more complicated. She said he is not a fanatic. Of course, obviously he's not a fanatic, anti-Semite, insane, and so on. It's much complicated sentence, but it's all said in a very ironical way. She never thought he is not anti-Semite. She never thought that he is not fanatic anti-Semite. I mean, it's all very ironic, and all her book about Eichmann is written ironically. It's like, how you say, tongue in the cheek, tongue in cheek. Way of reading, it's hilarious. It's something that you cannot understand and you cannot grasp only by humor and only by irony, because it's unperceivable in no other way. The rationalizations that Eichmann and his fellows invent in order to justify their acts, it's something that you cannot You cannot relate to it, but with humor. And she had a great humor. But by the way, Primo Levi did the same, you know? It's a different approach that very, very few people really had straight after the war. Primo Levi did the same, and he never was blamed for this. And I asked some of my interviewers, why it's so? Why wouldn't you blame Primo Levi? I got a terrible answer. He was in concentration camp, so he's allowed for everything. She wasn't there. How did she does she dare, you know?
Sehen Sie, wenn man, es gibt Leute, die Leute nehmen mir eine Sache übel. Und das kann ich gewissermaßen verstehen von außen. Nämlich, dass ich da noch lachen kann. Mhm. Nicht? Mhm. Und ich war wirklich der Meinung, dass der Eichmann ein Hanswurst ist. Und ich sage Ihnen, ich habe dieses Polizeiverhör 3600 Seiten gelesen und sehr genau gelesen. Und ich weiß nicht, wie oft ich gelacht habe, aber laut.
I think that the young generation sometimes doesn't even understand what it's all about. I mean, what is the problem? I mean, it's so obvious. It became a cliché in a way. You know, people don't think about it also very deeply because it's understandable that evil is part of the world and that we are all part of it and we are all responsible to it to some extent. I mean, it doesn't mean that we have to take the blame away from the big evildoers. It's not, as Hannah Arendt said, it's not, we are not sharing the blame, but we share responsibility because we are all part of this world and we are all contributing to the cliché of this world, to the norms of this world, to the ethoses of this world. And we contribute to evil by keeping silence. It's also a way to contribute to evil. So we have all a responsibility for the world we created. And this is where banality of evil transformed to be a political thinking.
At the same time, the human need for justice can find no satisfactory reply in considering all German people as equally guilty. Where all are considered guilty, nobody can be judged. For that guilt is not accompanied by even the mere pretense of responsibility. Guilt implies the consciousness of guilt, and punishment requires evidence that the criminal is a responsible person.
Yeah, in Israel she's known very well because of her criticism about Zionism since 1944. Up to 1944, she was great Zionist. And then she was, because she understood so well the idea of refugee, she believed that the Jewish people need a home, a political home. And one of her very important principle, political thinking, the principle of political thinking about Palestine was that we need to find a polity or some solution that will create equality for majority and minority as the same.
American Zionists from left to right adopted unanimously the demand for a free and democratic Jewish commonwealth, which shall embrace the whole of Palestine. This is a turning point in Zionist history, for it means that the revisionist program, so long bitterly repudiated, has finally proved victorious. This time, the Arabs were simply not mentioned in the solution, which obviously leaves them the choice between voluntary immigration and second-class citizenship.
For me, she's a Jewish philosopher that was born in Germany, and she's also a Jewish refugee all her life, you know. And as a Jewish refugee, she managed to universalize the idea of refugee. And being a refugee for her was really very important because it was, as Professor Edith Zertal said in my movie, it's a state of mind. It's a state of mind to be a refugee. It gives you a different angle of life, the angle of the underdog. And as Judith Butler said that she universalized her being a Jewish exile and created by this kind of commitment to the idea of refugee and to the refugees all over the world. And I can add from my insight that I think for her, being the idea of refugee is also an angle to understand all the dark dynamics of exclusion of the other, all the kind of exclusion, because if you come to think of it, we are all refugees. We are all caught in the net of some exclusion, some labeling, some stereotypes, some images. And I think she opened the way of thinking in this direction very strongly.
Your slave to go. Show me the place I've forgotten, I don't know. Show me the place where my head is bending low. Show me the place where you want your slave to go.